that was planted in my brain still remains within the sound of silence.
In restless dreams I walked alone, narrow streets of cobblestone, neath the halo of a street lamp. I turned my collar to the cold and damp, when my eyes were stabbed by the flash of a neon light that split the night and touched the sound of silence.
And in the naked light I saw 10,000 people, maybe more. People talking without speaking, people hearing without listening, people writing.
I would like to ask your attention. I must tell that this is not my favorite job, to announce that we are going close to the end, but this is how it is. And I think we have a very rich, intensive, and nourishing 4 days behind us. And here is, this is the closure phase. Although Huxley said that the experience is not what happens to a man, it is what a man does with what it happens to him. Means that in the closure phase, we should reflect back what happened with us. I would like to invite you just a little bit to reflect and think back these 4 amazing days. So please take the moment and just settle down a little bit as you're sitting here. If you wish, you can close your eyes and think back. Think back how it started, how you arrived, the first days, workshops. Recall your memory. What meetings, what conversations happened? Find one good thing. What was remarkable for you? It can be anything. What is popped up today, here and now, and what seems important for you. It can be a smile, it can be a meaningful thought, it can be an insight for you, a hug. It can be anything. What is important. And now just think, why do you choose this memory? What does it mean to you? What does it give to you? What does it remind to you? What is the meaning of it for you. And just take this meaning away, home with you. This is the gift of this conference. Thank you, and let me share what is my gift from you. Actually, I would share two. One is a thought from yesterday. I was at Malcolm's workshop, and he had a question to us. He asked that what we think, how many people in the world are we influenced to? How many people are living who affected by us, who affected by our thoughts, who affected by our opinion, who affected by our values, our Gestalt values? And just think, 100, 200, think about the family members, think about your friends, think about your clients, even individual clients, or in the organization, if you work with organizations. How many people are influenced? 1,000. And how many people influenced by those who influenced by you? Another 1,000? 1,000,000? So that was a very powerful insight for me. I was just thinking after a lot that how big possibilities and how big responsibilities we have, how we can influence people with our values, with our thoughts, with our footprint. We talk a lot about that, how we can diminish our harmful ecological footprint, which is very important. But we have different footprints also. We have healing footprints. So what I will take with me from this conference is that I try to encourage myself, and also I try to encourage you to walk along through the world and leave your healing footprints wherever you go. And my other gifts, what I will take away with me is your eyes, your faces, your smile, your hugs. I got a lot of hugs from you during these 4 days, and I fill up my tank, I think, for years with hugs. Thank you very much. Thank you for being here. It was an honor for me. And also, thank you for my organizing team, my colleague, who did fantastic job in the last 2.5 years. So I would like to invite you to come up to the stage. France, please, you too. And I would like to ask the volunteers also who are still here to come up to the stage, work a lot during these 4 days. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
I also would like to say a huge thank you to the helpers in the online space who supported us with their sharing and presence, the ambassadors of the conference, Sally Denenbagen. Sally, are you here? I don't see you. Liv Estrop. Despina Balaou from Greece. And Margarita Espanolo Lob. So we do thank you again for their presence around us.
And during this whole process, we had a lot of support for people who were willing to review the workshops. That was a group of about, I think, 40. I'm not sure. I think a group of 40 people who took the task on them to each read about 10 or 15 workshops and say, yes, this we can do. So thank you to all these people who contribute. And please, let's not forget the people from the conference place here. I don't know how you experienced. I think they did a marvelous job with the coffee, the food, and the service. All the time friendly.
So, we are closing the end, but not absolutely the end. So, I would like to invite Beatrix to the stage and a little bit talking about the future. And Renata.
Thank you, Judith. Well, we have now arrived to the point where we say goodbye to each other. And I want to share something about my experience as well, and I want to thank you, Lynn, for your words this morning, because they expressed something about what I was experiencing here as well. So, for me, it's very helpful to see what I experience, that we are making and being made of the situation. And that you mentioned that the void can also be, it can be fertile, but it also can be pretty scary. So this is something that I experienced in both qualities. And what I find really important is that we are aware of that we are always coming from a perspective, as you said. We are never neutral, and we are never without prejudice. And I hope that it was possible to stay with these polarities and exploring, at least it was for me, exploring both qualities of this void. On the one hand, the very fertile one, and to see what is emerging from this ground. And on the other hand, pretty scary not to know what is happening, how will this turn out. So I'm happy to hear that there are different voices. I spoke in the beginning also about the differences that we can explore with each other and find the richness in it. And I'm happy that it was possible to find the richness in this as well. We have two more points for now for the closing ceremony. So the first one is, we want to look to the future, and I want to present my colleague Renata Mizerska from Poland, who is the new president-elect for EAGT, and she will step into office next year when I'm leaving in September. Please, welcome Renata Mizerska.
Something? I am deeply touched now, and I was full of fear that I will be not able to say a word right now to you, because it's a new standpoint for me, and I am honored that I am taking this with you here in Budapest during our conference. Some of you know me, some of you don't, and I would like to say that I am a person full of energy and a lot of ideas and a big heart for every people and Gestalt therapy, and that's why I decided to take this step, and I am looking forward to take other steps together with you, because I don't feel I will be able to do it on my own. Thank you.
So we want to say thank you for those two presentations, and we will take this kind of atmosphere with us now and process this in a democratic way with our organizations. And it's now time to say goodbye, actually. But there was Nurit Levy who wanted to say something for the end of the conference.
Thank you for allowing me to say that. And at the risk of becoming the bad girl in this huge room, I can't leave here without sharing with you, thanks to Judith, who took us to a beautiful reflection of this experience and asked us to keep in mind and remember a special moment. The polarity I couldn't avoid too. This was a wonderful experience here in Budapest, and you made a wonderful job, a rich and beautiful conference from which I take a lot of warm hugs, smiles, and friendships. But my friends, I couldn't help wondering what actually happened to our values and norms that you mentioned before, Lynn. And I couldn't but really feel in my body how we are affected and how we affect the situation, as you said. And I just want to throw a reflection that I wish you take with you as a question to think about. The only formal space that was granted for us as a community to put our heads and hearts together in order to consider what is happening in this world, namely the panel offered by the Committee for Human Rights and Social Responsibility, was honored by three participants. We deeply appreciate their coming, and we couldn't help but wonder what it says about our priorities. And I hope you will consider this also when we go on, each of us, to our work, and when we come together next time for our conference. Thank you very much, and let's meet together and work.
Thank you.
Thank you, Nurit, for adding this very meaningful contribution to the closing and to the reflection of the conference. We are coming now to an end. I thank you very much. I thank the organizers who have done a fantastic job. And I hope you can leave here with a basket of meaningful meetings, encounters, and moments that you can really cherish in your hearts. Thank you very much, and see you either in Latvia or in Spain. We will see.
Thank you very much. And while looking forward into the future, please don't forget here and now. I hope you really enjoyed your stay here in Budapest. And I would like to remind you there's a chance, a great opportunity to say goodbye to your process group team members after a short coffee break. But there are some changes with the meeting rooms of some of these process groups. So groups from number 37 to number 50, except the number 40 and 46. You have to stay here in the Patria room, in the Patria hall, because you will have your meeting here at the same place. But now, please be our guest for a short coffee break. And I would like to say thank you for you all, for your patience and for your attention. It was my pleasure to be here with you, and thank you for this invitation. Have a nice day. Thank you.
To Jack van Liesdonk, as for those who don't know him yet, he's our treasurer, but he's also vice president of the organization. And we will now proceed to the next point of presenting the places for the next conference. Before we are going to this topic, I want to refer to a process that maybe not all of you have been involved, or certainly not all of you have been involved, that we had in our last annual general meeting that took place on Thursday. So there was a proposal brought from the Human Rights Committee, and we discussed it in the AGM, that we need to change and shape the process of how the next conference place is being chosen. So, where did Chuck go? Ah, he's here, okay. So, okay, he's good. The proposal was that we discussed at length at the annual general meeting, that it is not enough to see some nice pictures and say, oh, I want to go to that beach, that's very nice, like it happened when we decided to go to Armenia. But we have to take into account a couple of other thoughts about this. So where do we want to go with our organization? What kind of statement do we give if we go to the one place or to the other? So what we are suggesting and proposing to do is that we have two presentations today, and the members of our organization will have the chance to have a say in this, where we go, when we have taken the proposals back to our organization, to the governing body of EAGT, which is the general board, and within the general board to say, to tell you something about the structure of our organization. We have the EC and we have the general board of the organization. In the general board, there are representatives of all national organizations. The committees are there, the chairs of the committees are there. And this is where we take decisions in a democratic and informed way within our organization. So what we are going to do is, we are going to engage with the national organizations and also ask for your wishes and votes through these organizations. I give the word to Jack as well.
Okay. About the EAGT conferences, it's always a joint effort of a NOCHT from a country and the European organization. It's a co-production. And we noticed that we need to have more common ground to make the steps for the next conference. And you can't create a common ground during a presentation. And I'm very pleased what I see about the presentation already from Lithuania, Latvia, difficult for me to distinguish the words. I know exactly where the countries are. With their leaflets and the sweets, and so it's very present. And I really know that 6 years ago, when we were in Krakow, and there was a presentation of that country as well, and from the Netherlands and from Taormina, and we voted there in after a presentation, after 3 days of conference, where we were tired, and all those peaches, they were delicious and promising. And we mustn't deny ourselves to have those emotions or those feelings. But I think we need to involve our brain as well. And that takes time and another moment. So I'm very curious about the both presentations, about presentations from Spain. We already had some pre-contact because they asked us, are there things that we have to take into account for a conference? And the both presentations, we need to create some more knowledge and understanding of what are we going, which way are we going. So that's why we decided to have it this way. The first presentation?
Yes, please.
Is there an order?
No.
Well, who's first? Who wants to be first? Who wants to be second?
Latvia.
So we welcome the team of Latvia to do the presentation and their proposal for the host for hosting the next EAGT conference, the 14th conference for the EAGT.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. We show you a small presentation about Latvia, and we invite it to Latvia. Please. Laser movement. Okay. Attention.
Latvia is a perfect place to raise self-awareness. Everything here is compact and continuously changing.
So we have been talking about field theory, contact, the art of contact for all of those days. And we would like to experience this fertile void right now here. And we would like to join us if you want.
Welcome to Latvia. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this lovely, energetic presentation. And Spain? David Pico.
Should I use this?
Can you? Can you hear me if I don't use this machine? Okay. Good. I guess that I have. Wait a second. Okay. This works. Well, hello. I'm so impressed that I was telling them I hope I won't faint. And I'm very relieved that the voting won't take, to know now that the voting won't take place here, because I was feeling a little bit like a Eurovision singer. Like now I have to do something so that will be Spain 2 points, L'Espagne 2 points. So well, I mean, couldn't do that. So, and somehow this is a bit of the Eurovision of Gestalt. And I'm very happy to be here, as I was, something I was talking about in my process group and also with my wife and some other people is that my wife and I were saying, oh, see, there are two Russians here, and there is some Polish, and we were so surprised to find people from Eastern Europe, because in our experience, and this is very sad, we never meet anyone for the Eastern European countries. And otherwise, we had people saying, oh, when I asked, oh, where are you from? From Spain. Oh, you're from Spain. So I've been feeling so exotic here. That's very new. And being exotic has some fun part, because it's like, yeah, the Spanish, you know, but it's also feeling distant. That's something I've been very sad about, because in the last 2 years and a half, I've been the Spanish representative for the Spanish Association in EAGT, and these have been 2 wonderful years, and I hope I will have more. But it has been beautiful, because I've been having the chance to meet every 6 months people from different countries, and that's an experience that we are not having in Spain, as I will tell you now. Let me tell you a few words about our association. It was created in 1982. That means 3 years before EAGT. Okay. If you think that our conference is in 2022, then you can subtract and see that it will be our 40th anniversary. So, take that in mind. That's a good point. We will be celebrating in any case. Okay, so if you want to join us, you're welcome. They will be, okay. So we are a big association, because the Spanish gestalt therapy world is a bit particular. We have 2,140 members and 64 institutes, which is a lot. It's just a lot. And also, the gestalt therapy is very big in Spain. We have best-selling books about gestalt therapy that many people know. So we are, as professionals, we are searched for as gestalt therapists quite often. However, let me say something else. The Spanish community in the history of gestalt therapy in Spain has had a strong connection with Latin America, obviously because of the language. That's the main reason. And our background comes strongly from the Latin American way of understanding gestalt therapy that has developed in the last 40, 50 years. That is good. I mean, that is good. But it has also had an effect that we strongly dislike. And it has to do with the disconnection that the Spanish community, gestalt community, has had from the rest of Europe. The Spanish NOCT Association is not a full member of EAGT, which is a shame, and in my opinion at least, and very few Spanish gestalt therapists are member of EAGT, and very few, something that adds to that is that very few, in particular, older people in Spain can speak English. It's also like a monolingual, maybe an empire. Lynn Jacobs was talking about that, and I felt touched that maybe the empire, is that English? Okay, the Spanish language has some strength that makes it difficult sometimes. So, also something important is that now gestalt therapy is being threatened in Spain in the same way or similar way that is happening in Poland, that happened in Germany years ago. So we are facing now a very difficult moment, because there are attempts to make regulations that will seriously threaten our practice. And now we have a feeling that it's in particular important to connect to the rest of Europe, and that's part of the work I've been doing with the EAGT as a representative. Okay, so what is happening now in Spain is that the younger generations, the new generations, we are having a big impulse, because we are basically young people in Spain, young gestalt therapists are saying no to isolation. We don't want to be isolated any longer. We had enough. Younger people are able to speak English. That is increasing. The Spanish Association, since it is big, it has some resources, and we are investing in research. We are in contact with the EAGT as well to see how we can help research in gestalt therapy develop. And we are very, young, I don't mean babies, I mean like 40s. We are young, like me, almost 50, young. We are interested very much in the Europeanity, in increasing our Europeanity in that sense. So let me talk about just a few things about the project that we are offering here. One of the main things is to share experiences. And share experiences, I mean, also put into contact the Spanish world of gestalt therapy, the rest of Europe world of gestalt therapy, the Eastern Europe world of gestalt therapy. We think that for us, if we are honored to be hosting the next conference, that would be something very important, because we want to know about everyone, and everyone to know about us. Something that is also important is to develop some sense of belonging for us, and that is increasing, but we want to belong, belong to the European Union. I'm not talking about politics. No, I'm talking about the gestalt community, to have a feeling that we are part of you, you are part of us, that there is not, the Pyrenees is not separating two different types of gestalts and we don't talk to each other. Okay, we want to make a tunnel through the Pyrenees. Okay, and something that adds to the project is that Spain, maybe in the same way as the UK, has a position in which our British friends have helped Americans come to Europe. Spain has that kind of situation as well. So part of the project will be to also connect with Latin American associations and therapists so that they could also participate in different ways in the conference. That's the project. Okay, so I didn't say the place. 1, 2, 3. Ta-da! Okay. I'm not from Madrid, so I will make an effort to advertise a city that is not my city, but well. Well, Madrid, why Madrid? Very, very quickly. Madrid is connection. Madrid has a huge airport that has flights every day to everywhere, to America in particular, to the rest of Europe. It's in the center of Spain, and which is a very centralistic country. So from Madrid, you can travel everywhere. There are roads going everywhere. There are trains, fast trains. You can go to the Mediterranean Sea in 1.5 hours to my city, by the way, Valencia, beautiful, visited. And you also have a subway, a very dense, a lot. That's not a problem at all. Also, something that is important is culture. Because Madrid, for instance, I guess you've heard of Museum of El Prado. Okay, that's the biggest painting museum in the world, and you have jewels of art. It's an impressive museum. But it's not only that. And the Spanish spirit, the way we organize, we had a conference a couple of years ago. We had 400 people, and it was full of music, theater, dancing, because that's the way we understand gestalt therapy. It's in a very playful way. That's part of the Spanish and Latin American contribution to gestalt therapy, I guess. What is the style, in any case? So that would be part of our contribution to this celebration. So we can add our touch to it. Because, and now I will be very a bit kitsch. but Madrid is, and let me use one of the most well-known words of the Spanish language. Madrid is fiesta. Okay. Yeah. Okay, so now I'm done with my presentation, but let me show you a 1 minute video, okay, about this. I hope they can show it. And don't vote, because you won't be voting, but I hope that we can welcome you next year, okay? Thanks.